beautiful day.
Since I met you,
oh, the sun is shining.
Yes, the sun is bright
within my soul. There's a melody of love,
a melody
that the songbird sings.
Yes, love is in the air.
It's a beautiful day.
Oh, what a beautiful day.
Since I found the Lord, I have new joy and perfect peace in my happy soul. Since the Savior made my life complete, there's love in my heart, a smile on my face, my cup, it overflows. It's a beautiful day.
Oh, what a beautiful day.
Since I found the Lord.
Doctor can't see you because your insurance does not, you know, you don't take your insurance. And there was no other doctors around, and they're telling me that I've got a 3-month window to get this taken care of. And I was not able to walk. I couldn't even do the movement to walk because I had been without movement in that leg for 2 months. And I lost everything. I would try on my own, and I couldn't do it. And that week after I got home, and I had gotten 2 bad phone calls, bad news, and I just sit in the chair. And I said, God, I said, all I want to do, I said, I just want to be able to walk again. And I said, I've had enough. I said, I've lost all, you know, trust and, you know, faith in doctors, and I knew that he could do anything. He's the one that we have to always turn to and have complete trust and faith in. And I stood up and I walked. And he was the one that did that. I couldn't do it. I tried every day myself. And of course, it was a struggle. It wasn't a normal walk. And they finally got me in with a physical therapist and to actually even come to the house. And she was, when she said the first time I seen you, she said, it was awful. She said, I couldn't believe the shape that you was in. She come for 3 weeks. And I seen her for the last time on Friday, and she was just totally amazed. And I said, it was God. I said, because I couldn't do that on my own, and nobody else would help me. These doctors wouldn't help. I couldn't even get the treatment that I really needed. And God gave me what I needed, and he's brought me so far. He's brought me through this, and this is, people don't understand the situation, very few people. And it's very complicated, and it can be very painful. When you can't do the things that you normally do, I can't do the job that I've always been. And it's very discouraging, but God is always there to help you through whatever. And I know that, he's promised me my healing, and I know that my complete healing will come because I trust in that. And he's already brought me so far around the house. I can walk fairly well. I still try to use a crutch when I'm out because if something happens. But I've been able to see my ankle bone. First time I've totally seen my bone on Friday in my foot. And I hadn't seen that since the end of February. And this is just, I know this has taught me to trust and to help build my faith. And I'm just so thankful for all the prayers, the cards, the visits, and everything from everybody. I really, really appreciate it so very much. And for my family that's helped me, taken me to doctor's appointments and people in the church that's helped me, taken me, and come and stayed with me. And I'm just so very thankful for what God has done for me and how he has helped me through all this. And I know that it's already okay.
Amen. And I just
thank you all so very much for all your prayers and everything.
Oh, it's Sister Amanda's birthday today, too, I was told. Happy birthday. And I'm sure that was the best birthday present that you could get, the Lord gave you. So we thank you, and I thank you for testifying. I enjoy hearing testimonies. I mean, we shouldn't give them unless we're inspired, but it touches everybody else, and we don't know what encouragement it's doing. Somebody may never say anything, but when you hear it, it speaks to that person's heart, and it's the Lord is worthy to be praised, and we thank him for that. All right, Sister Michelle. All right, Sister Diane, would you have a song tonight?
When you're up against a wall and your mountain seems so tall and you realize life's not always fair, you can run away and hide, let the old man decide, or you can change your circumstances with a prayer. When everything falls apart, praise his name. And when you have a broken heart, raise your hands and say, Lord, you're all I need, you're everything to me, and he'll take the pain away. When it seems you're all alone, hands and say, greater is He that is within me. You can praise the hurt away.
Jason and April here, are they? There you go. Okay. Thanks. Would you have one after tonight?
Overcomers in this life, we've been made victorious through the blood of Jesus Christ. Troubles, they come a-knocking at your door. Don't be afraid, you know it's not here before. Don't give in, don't you let it bring. You don't have to worry. The blood of Jesus.
there's no reason for us to go astray. Don't go leaning on your own understanding. We don't have to worry anymore. We've been made more than conquerors, overcomers in this life. We've been made victorious through the blood of Jesus Christ.
Thank you, sister. All right, Brother Jason, Sister April, and Sister Lori, would you have one with that?
get through the day. I'm going to take the time to pray and start my day with you.
For that. All right, Sister Lori. Sister Glenda. Yeah. Who would Sister Hope and Sister Becky have one after that?
I've had enough, but he gives. things along the way.
Thank you, sisters. All right, Sister Hope and Sister Becky. And Brother Clint, Sister Rebecca, would you have one after that?
You've been to the banker, he says no with regret. You've tried so many ways just to get ahead. You're hoping and praying for a miracle still, but God likes to work when nothing else will. Shook his head. You've suffered so many nights just lying in bed. You can't seem to make it. Your body is ill. But friend, our God likes to work when nothing else will. Oh, God likes to work when your back's to the wall. When fate's in the balance and you're just about to fall. Shook his head. You've suffered so many nights. They're lying. lying in bed. You can't seem to make it. Your body is ill. But hold on, God likes to work when nothing else will.
When Brother Steve said this morning that somebody asked him, do you think God cares about people before they're born? And I can't think about it without wanting to cry. When I was pregnant with Josiah, he wasn't due yet. It was 3 weeks away, and I hadn't been plagued with hypertension in that pregnancy like I was with Leah. And I went to that doctor's appointment, and my blood pressure was high, and I'm like, what? Like, hope if we can't get it down, you're going to have to go, you know, have your child. And it wouldn't come down. So we went over 3 weeks early, and boys actually don't do very well around the 37th week. But, like, the Lord's in control. And when I had him, she didn't immediately hand him to me. And I was like, and then he cried, and I forgot all about that. And when I went back later and asked, I said, so what happened? And she said, well, he was all wrapped up in his cord like three times, twice around his neck, once around his belly, or vice versa. And I thought, Lord, he hadn't even taken his first breath. And you were mindful, and I'm so grateful, because another 3 weeks, kids can gain a pound and a half a week. He could have, you know, been, he could have not made it. And I thank the Lord for my Josiah.
Yes.
And his mercy.
All right, Brother Flint, Sister Rebecca.
There's a burden I can't bear, a sorrow I can't share. Lord, I just can't carry anymore. I'm weary from the fight. It seems my strength and might have slipped away. Lord, I'm just a sheep, I must be fed. Lord, I'm just a sheep, I must be fed. Even though I count my life as lost, oh Lord, would you help me with this cross? There's a valley up ahead, questions in my head.
mountain, I must climb it on my own. We a people, Lord, we must rise and must be led. Lord, I'm just a sheep, I must be fed. Even though I count my life as lost,
recently, and it's amazing the difference between the place that I was and where I am now. And like Brother Kevin was saying the other day, that if it's a job that's just taking everything away from you, get out of it. Just get out of it. Pray, and God will see you through that. And I've been sick, me and Rebecca both, and I shouldn't even be able to sing, truly. I think I'm better now, actually, that I come up here, and I give God the glory and honor for that.
I thank each and every one of you for your songs tonight. They've truly just built on top of each other as they've come out. So let's get ready to hear that word and be fed as the sheep right now. So let's go ahead and stand.
Well, praise the Lord tonight, everybody. I hope everyone is happy, feeling good, trusting the Lord, anchoring in His Word. Praise Him. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we're grateful to You again that You've given us another wonderful day and that You've brought us to this opportunity tonight that You've given us. We thank You for Your mercy and grace to us and for everything, Lord, that You have benefited us in and life, and then, Lord, for salvation through Jesus Christ. May You be with Your people now. Bless those that will be listening throughout the land and throughout the world, Lord. You see our brothers and sisters in South Africa and Norway and Philippines, as well as others here in this country and around the world, Lord, where they'll be able to see. May You bless Your people. May You bless Your children, Lord, here tonight. And may You give me unction to be able to say those things that would be pleasing to You. Thank You, Father, now for everything. Thank You in advance, Lord, for everything that we are expecting of You. Because we know that Your word is promised for this hour that we're living in. So, Lord, You give us much more than what we deserve. I know You do me. And I thank You for that. And I thank You for the saints of God. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you, Brother Bud. Hope that everyone has had a wonderful day today. No reason not to, because the Lord is good. Good all the time. And we thank Him for that. I think I got one chapter this morning in the book of Matthew. And that's just three or four verses, but sometimes you just feel led to go in a direction of which that you hadn't even planned yourself. I know that it's set away with me, and I just have to say, Lord, You get the benefit out of it, because we're not here to please ourselves. Here to please Him, and if the word hits my flesh, then by the words that I say, then I'm responsible, as well as you are, because truly, the Lord is leading His ministry in this hour to say things that sometimes haven't been spoken. Other times to unction it, and things that have been spoken. So we praise His name for His wonderful grace to us, for the day and hour that He's given us to be able to live in. And may He be praised in it all. I want to go to Matthew chapter 16 tonight, and you know, the Jews always referred back to Moses. They would never let go of that, and they compared Moses to the word that Jesus was saying. This is not the way Moses said it. Many times it's set away today in this hour. You didn't say it like Brother Branham did. You didn't say it like Brother Jackson did. But as long as it's carrying the same message, the message is what counts. The truth of the Word of God. You're not trying to do something opposite or preach something different. But sometimes, just like the Godhead. I mean, this was something that needed unction to, and needed to be straightened out in some people's minds. Just like other things that my brothers have spoken about, I remember years ago when Brother Bud brought out Isaiah 52:8. It had not been spoken before. But when we see eye to eye, then that is bringing unity. Amen. Unity to the believers. Yes. That's what we are still preaching, unity. And I think that I will put these down a little bit there. I know that there's some that won't be able to see the See, the board here don't make any difference whether you see me or not. Thank you, Brother Bud. I'm getting in his way, and I was needing a drink of water. We got people today that, just like it was in Jesus' time, that when they quoted Moses, Moses said. They weren't willing to go any far, and here even Jesus quotes to them, "He spoke of me," he said, which he did. When he said that a prophet, "Shall the Lord thy God raise up until ye like unto me, him shall ye hear, and everyone that won't hear will be cut off from among the people." As I read from Matthew a couple weeks ago there, where Matthew 24, where that he was talking about the scripture of where that he was more or less saying that that Jerusalem is going to fall. And he cried over it. He said, "O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, if you had known the day of your visitation, if you'd only known the day of your visitation, but you didn't know it. So your house is left unto you empty." He even said that he would have been willing to gather them together as a chicken or a hen doth its brood. I lived on a farm. I remember when a chicken hawk would fly over. That hen would let out some clucks, and those little chickens run under, because she was warning. A chicken hawk could make a sound, its sound. The little chickens would scramble to get under her, because they knew that was their protection, and that's what Jesus was referring to. He knew something about farm life. He knew about fishing. And he used those illustrations. Just like he talked to the corn of wheat. Just like he talked to his disciples, "I will make you fishers of men." He caught more fish one time than the disciples ever did by fishing all night. Because he brought them into the boat of Peter and them, and they began to sink, and they had to put them into another boat. But you know, today, the message that we know and understand is not accepted by the world. You can't do nothing about it, because it's done been spoken, just like those words were to the Jews. Matthew 13, verse 47, where it tells about a net being cast into the sea and gathered of every kind. We've seen it. Methodists, Baptists, Catholic, unbelievers, make believers, and then there's that true believer. That's the one out of all of it that he's after. There's just one thing that he was after whenever he said the net was cast into the sea, because he tells about all those others. But you know, if people listen to Scripture, they would know what he was talking about. They would know about him talking about the net being cast into the sea and gathered of every kind. They were gathered. Because he said, many are called, but few are chosen. They have these fish tournaments. They have a bass tournament. They can catch a lot bigger fish than bass. They're not after carp. They're not after catfish. And I'm sure that sometimes they hook some of those. I don't know nothing about a bass tournament. I just heard about them. Seen them on the news or something like that. I don't know anything about them. But I know that they're not looking for anything else. And Almighty God is big enough to know what He's after. He's big enough to know where the catch is. Because in among all those that were dragged to the shore, most of them were thrown back. Because that wasn't what he was after. He's after hearts that will follow him. When he called 12 apostles, he said, follow me. He didn't give them the second choice. He never gave us the second choice in this hour. I'll just keep my membership down in the Methodist Church. I remember I went to the Methodist Church when I told them to take my name off. Preacher, I listened to the preacher preach. He got up and preached. He said, if you're a good Methodist, said whenever you go to another community, he done knew that I'd left the Methodist Church. Or you go to another city, then you will take your membership to the Methodist Church there. I sat and listened to him. It got through. I went to him, told him to take my name off. That hurts. That hurts them because they just lost somebody that they thought would be a benefit to them. But we're in this to win. We're not in it to lose. In Matthew chapter 16, verse 24. Then said Jesus unto his disciples. Brother Kevin, sometimes Jesus was hard. You think the message that maybe that I preached this morning or last week was hard? Jesus deliberately preached things to see His following. Because after he had fed 5,000, the next day he says to the people that they, after they had eaten, they'd even thought about making him king. He said, except you eat the flesh of the Son of Man, drink his blood, you have no life in you. That's hard. He meant it sometimes to be hard. But because the believer is going to catch it. And it's not hard for them.
Amen.
Truth is not hard on a believer.
Amen. Praise the
Lord. It may get on their toes at times. I tell you, whenever I first heard serpent seed, it's just like a snap. It come to me. But there are people that said, Brother Branham, the devil was the one inspiring him. Oh yeah, they accepted the bread and the fishes. They was willing to be pulled out of the water. But you get a fish out of water, he's not going to live long. Those other things, you can throw them back in because it's their nature. What do you mean by that? A fish won't live long after you get him out of the water. We're not meant to live. We're meant to give our lives, to take up our cross and cross at death. Understand what I mean now? Because it may lay there and flop a little while, but after a while it gives it up. But a believer will not fight and fight and fight. They may be certain things that makes them stumble. But some way they will get up. And they will realize that is right. That was right all the time. I'm not trying to make Jesus out of somebody of being a hard taskmaster, but I'm saying that he is going to wreck somebody. But he's going to save others.
Amen. Yes.
Just like the scripture that I read there this morning. About them saying, strive to enter in. Push your way. Don't let the devil push you. You've got a right. You've got a right to the tree of life. And that tree of life is the Holy Ghost. I remember Brother Branham talking about it. He said that the serpent got to Eve before that God did. Before the Holy Ghost did. If sin had never happened, they would have received the Holy Ghost. But no way that the devil could have touched them. As I said, verse 24, Then said Jesus unto his disciples, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. That I was talking to you about that on that tent this morning. There's no way they could get me to be a chaplain. I wouldn't fool with that stuff. For what is a man profited? If he gained the whole world, and lose his soul. The world tonight is after this. They're after that.
Amen.
And they're conniving.
Right.
You've got government leaders tonight that are more conniving than what the mafia is. They're not interested in us. They're interested in the next election because, especially Congress, because they're elected every 2 years, the whole bunch of them. They start running for Congress as soon as they are elected. They don't want to give it up. They claim once they get to Washington, they don't want to leave. And you can see that. If they had to put a cap on their stay there a long time ago, then maybe things would have been a little different. They're in talking about another election in Israel because they just got a 61-59 margin. And they don't think that the thing can last a full year without another election. And there Netanyahu, he said, we won't give up any land. We won't give up Jerusalem. Immediately after he's elected, he's talking about it. Not Jerusalem, but Judea. Go ahead and try it. You've got the opportunity. Try to throw out 300 and some thousand people out of Judea. See what you get. They expel 9,000 out of Gaza and they like to not got them out. That land belongs to nobody but Israel. It don't belong to the Palestinians. It don't belong to the UN. It don't belong to America.
Right. Amen.
Leave it alone. Get your hands and your claws off of it. That's God's land. Look at it. In the 37th chapter of the book of Ezekiel, the first thing that is converted renewed is the land, the mountains, before. And you can see it going on. Israel's the only nation in the world that they are able to salvage 73% of their water. Spain second with 23%. There where California's so dry and all, Jerry Brown said, the governor, he said, you people have got to conserve 30%. They've conserved 4%. Four. They hired somebody from Israel to come and to show them how to save water. They went there and they tried to tell them to get it from the sea and desalt it. They didn't do it. California is getting ready to sink. And Yellowstone Park. It's raising and then going down, raising. And they found out that underneath it, it is twice as big as they thought. The fault line. What happened? What happened to Sodom and Gomorrah? What is it? How many states have accepted gay marriage already? Bruce Jenner made Women's Magazine. Oh, he's an ugly woman. I reckon that's what he is. He don't know. The devil is taking over men's mind. I read this morning about how that he'd turn them over to a reprobate mind. To believe a lie. As Paul said, to believe a lie and be damned. For whosoever shall save his life shall lose it. And whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. For what is a man profited if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? For what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? Brother, sister, God has given us great things. We could be out there in that quagmire. But we're not. We've given up. This morning, during the service this morning, I just felt like in it come close, something just leaping out.
It's getting close.
Yes, it is.
And that feeling is going to produce fruition. And whenever it does, this whole assembly will shake.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
As it did in the book of Acts.
Amen.
Shake us, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Wake us to righteousness. Let us not be stragglers.
Amen.
I'm your pastor, not by choice. But how many wants that? How many want something to just feel you to the uttermost of where that we can say we're not our own? We've been bought. Bought and paid for. God didn't leave anything out on his part. I know some of you young people are wanting something. Maybe some of the older people.
Yes.
How many wants more?
Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
It'll dissolve all doubts.
Right.
It'll take away fears.
Right.
It will take away unbelief.
Yes, it will.
It's about here.
Right.
It's coming. Brother Branham said, the bride has not had a revival. Brother Jackson comes along and says the same thing. She's not had a revival yet. But we got to be expecting it. We are the last generation.
Yes, Lord. Amen.
What shall it profit a man if he gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? I thought of that old song, what would you give in exchange? What would you give in exchange for your soul? Oh, if today God called you away, what would you give in exchange for your soul? Life here is very short. I'm learning that. Whenever the Bible says life is a vapor, if you're 20 years old tonight, you think that life is long. But when you get to the age that I am, you'll see that it's been very short. Because your mind still works as it did when you was young. For the Son of Man shall come in the glory of His Father. My, what a day that's going to be. When my Jesus,
hallelujah,
I shall see.
Yes.
It says, we shall see Him as He is for ourselves and not another. Brother Kevin, Brother Bud's going to see Him. I'm going to see Him.
Praise the Lord.
We won't have to ask somebody else to show us to us. He's not going to be on a television screen. He'll be everywhere.
Praise the Lord.
The presence of the Almighty is going to fill this earth as the water that covers the sea. I love Him tonight. I adore Him. I feel Him.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
He's here.
Hallelujah.
That inspires me. Hallelujah. For the Son of Man shall come in the glory of His Father. Those things that trouble you. Those aches and pains. Give it over. Just as our sister was testifying tonight.
That's right. Amen.
Give it over to Him. We're not to be pitied.
Praise the Lord.
We're too strong for that.
Amen. Hallelujah.
God done too much for us. If you never, which I'm not saying that, I believe you will. But if you go to glory, with a headache, it's going to be worth it all. But I don't believe you will. I believe the time is coming, and the time is here, and the time is near. Let's quit feeling sorry for ourselves. Poor me. That's making Him look small. Nobody hurts like me. Sometimes there's things that come that's worse than pain in the flesh. Sometimes you just got to throw off. Get rid of those things that trouble you, that bother you. When you come to the altar, leave it there.
Right. Amen. Amen.
Or if you make an altar in your home, I'm not saying don't come up here. Let us get settled in our mind that God cares for us. We're important to Him. For the Son of Man shall come in the glory of His Father. God has poured His glory out upon His Son. And when He comes, we'll see that glory.
Amen.
Right?
Amen. Praise the Lord.
What a privilege to be able to see Him in His glory and be a part of it.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
I could call each one of you out by name and say, encourage yourself.
Yes.
Don't let the devil get the best of you. You don't know how I feel. The Bible says, weeping comes before the night, but joy comes in the morning.
Glory to God. Amen.
Smack the devil.
Amen.
Don't let him smack you around.
Right.
You're a child of a king. With His angels. And then shall He reward. He's bringing it with Him. The reward is coming with Him. Brother Jerry, that's right.
Praise the Lord.
You won't be smelling those welding fumes anymore. But He likes to do it now. We should be getting some joy out of things now. Not walk around with the mully grubs. Just hate our life. Just hate everything we do. Every once in a while, when you do something stupid, like sometimes I do, laugh at yourself. Put one over on old Satan.
Right.
Sure, there are times that I have to apologize to God. I have to say, sorry, Lord Jesus. Please help me to be a better person. I'm not talking about it. Some gross sin or something that you get out here, but something you feel that you have unpleased Him about. Or not pleased Him, whichever one. And He shall reward every man according to his works. That is what we're doing here. Not according to the works over here, but according to the works that we're doing here. He's going to reward us according to our attitudes, according to our desires, according to our hopes, according to the way that we feel about Him, according to the way we feel about our brothers and sisters. Do I really love you? Do I really care about your cares? About your sicknesses? About your pain? I miss you when you're not here. I feel for you when you're sick. I feel for my brothers that have other people working for them. about my sisters that's working in these factories. Everything is not joyous. I spent 31 years in factory life. And another 3 years in factory life in Cincinnati. We're going to go into Matthew chapter 10. Working my way backward, look like here. I'm going to have to hurry this up because I got something I want to show you all in a few minutes. Starting 37, verse 37. He that loveth father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. That's hard. He that loveth son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. I told you this morning about the young boy, 10 years old, just give his heart to the Lord. Just a few days ago, a few weeks ago. ISIS caught him. Called his mom and dad. They told him, recant. Accept the Muslim faith. I don't know why they call it faith, because it's not faith. They said they couldn't do that. Them dirty devils. I don't care to call them that. Cut the little boy in two right in front of their eyes. To me, that is enough for our military forces to go in there and do away with ISIS. Why do they let them live? You say, you shouldn't talk like that. God talked like that. Look at Revelation 17. Look at Revelation 20. When judgment comes, that's bringing those that have already died, that have already suffered, bringing them up from the dead. To be judged for the last time, and there they will stand in human flesh. I thought it was just their spirits. It says their bodies. To stand before an almighty God. Whenever they do, their knees will bow. Every knee shall bow to God and confess that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. To the glory of God the Father. One last time, this is it. All these atheists on the news this afternoon. There's a comet out there somewhere. They don't know where it is. But if it hit New York, there'd be no more New York. Hitting the heart of this country, it would kill everything close to it. There was a place out in Arizona that Brother Steve took us a few years back, where a comet, piece of a comet about 45 feet long, hit the earth and it just made a mushroom. 3/4 of a mile wide, 100 yards deep. That's what it is now. The last one, last big one that hit, it's Siberia, where there's no population hardly. It laid trees down like sticks for miles and miles. One hit a glancing blow to Iceland. They said if it had come straight down, it would have wiped it out. Just 3 or 4 years ago. What does the Bible say? Stars of heaven shall fall to the earth. God's got enough junk out there. That's pieces of rocks. Granite. It'll come through this sky some 40,000 miles an hour. There'll never be an atomic bomb that's got that kind of power. Brother, sister, we're in the last day.
Yes.
And I'm going to show you something here. I want you to see this. I saw this 2 or 3 weeks ago and asked Brother David to show it.
It's April 29th, 2015. 226 years ago this day, George Washington readied himself for the first ever presidential inauguration to take place the following day, the day that America as we know it came into existence, with the president's hand resting on the word of God. That day would conclude with America's first government gathering in prayer to dedicate the nation's future to God. A century and a half earlier, another seminal event took place on the same day. On April 29, 1607, the voyagers on the Susan Constant, the Discovery, and the Godspeed gathered together in prayer at Cape Henry to set a wooden cross in the sands of Virginia Beach and to dedicate the new civilization to the will and the purposes of God. America's biblical foundation would be affirmed and reaffirmed over and over again by its forefathers.
From He's talking to Congress.
From the Mayflower to the Puritans of Massachusetts Bay to the leaders of the first American colonies who declared publicly and in writing that the new Commonwealth had come into existence solely for the glory and purposes of God. No historian can rewrite that. No president can expunge that. And if 1,000 angels swore in 1,000 Bibles that this was not the case, it would in no way alter the fact that this American civilization was conceived, established, dedicated, and founded on a biblical cornerstone. America was brought into existence for the will and the purpose of God. On this night, over 200 years ago, George Washington held in his hand the first ever presidential address. In that address was a prophetic warning. It was this: the propitious smiles of heaven can never be expected on a nation that disregards the eternal rules of order and right which heaven itself hath ordained. In other words, if America should ever turn away from God and his ways, if it should ever disregard his eternal rules of order and right, then his blessings, the smiles of heaven, would be removed from the land. It was an ancient warning. It had been given in Hebrew words by the prophets to the kingdom of Israel. But Israel turned away from God and disregarded his eternal rules of order and right. They drove God out of their government, out of their public squares, out of their culture, out of the lives of their children. They worshipped idols and served other gods. They celebrated immorality and they persecuted righteousness. They lifted up their children on the altars of foreign gods. And the blessings of God were removed from the land and replaced with judgment. It is 2,500 years later, and America has made the same mistake. We too have turned away from God. We too have driven him out of the government, out of our public square, out of our culture, out of the lives of our children. We too have profaned the sacred and sanctified the profane. And we too have killed our most innocent, over 55 million of our unborn children, and our collective hands are covered with blood. What we were warned never to do, we now have done. And now we gather in the city named after the one who gave us the prophetic warning. And yesterday in this city, in the building that sits across from this hill, the justices of the Supreme Court took up their places on the bench to decide whether America should strike down the biblical and historic definition of marriage. The very fact that an event should take place as such is a sign in itself that this is the America of Washington's warning. It's here. And this day of which he warned is now. We have become a civilization in spiritual schizophrenia, a nation at war against its own foundation. The Supreme Court opens its sessions with the words, God save the United States and this honorable court. But if this honorable court should overrule the word of God and strike down the eternal rules of order and right that heaven itself hath ordained, how then will God save it? Supreme Court justices, can you judge the ways of God? Can you with man-made verdicts overrule the eternal laws of God? There is another court, and there is another judge, and before him all men and all judges will give account. If a nation's high court should pass judgment on the Almighty, should you then be surprised that the Almighty should pass judgment on the court and that nation? In the book of Jeremiah it's written, has a nation ever exchanged its gods? Yet my people have exchanged their glory for that which cannot help them. Let us not pretend as to what we are now doing. We are doing that which Israel did on the altars of Baal. We are exchanging our God for idols, our light for darkness, and our glory for that which cannot save us. Are we ready to risk that which comes on the other side of that exchange, the day when the blessings of heaven are removed from the land? We began with a word from the president of our first nations, the day that he began as president. I now speak a word to the president of our nation's most recent days. Each time I've spoken here, I've asked a question. I'll now answer it. Mr. President, with all respect that is due, what happens if one assumes the presidency by placing his left hand on the word of God, and then with his right hand enacts laws that war against the very same word of God on which he laid his hand? Such an act invokes the judgment of the Almighty. To swear an oath on the word of God on which it's written, defend the weak and do not murder, and then to not defend the weak, to not protect the unborn, but instead to advance their murder, is to invoke the judgment of the Almighty. To swear an oath on the word of God in which it's written, do not cause your brother to stumble, and then to seek to force those who uphold the word of God to transgress the word of God by partaking in the killing of the unborn and the celebration of sin, is to invoke the judgment of the Almighty. And to swear an oath on the word of God in which it's written, righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people, and then to take part in the leading of a nation away from the eternal rules of order and right that heaven itself hath ordained, and against the very word of God on which you laid your hand, is to invoke the judgment of the Almighty. When the leaders of ancient Israel turned away from God, when they abolished his precepts and broke his covenant, they did so in the shadow of Moses, whose voice cried out to them in warning. Mr. President, when you address the nation from this house, look up above the senators and the representatives, above the Supreme Court justices and above the invited guests, and you'll see a face, the only full visage in that wall. Looking back at you, it is the face of Moses. And if that face could speak, it would say this: no man can overrule the laws of God, no order can annul the order of God, and no judgment of man can stand against the judgments of God. Invoke not his judgment, but choose life. Lead in the way of repentance. Invoke the grace of God that he might have mercy on this land. We've come to a most critical moment. As Elijah stood on top of Mount Carmel and cried out to Israel in his hour of decision in between two altars and two gods, his voice now cries out to America and says, choose you this day whom you will serve. 70 years ago, the chaplain of the United States Senate cried out with the same voice and said to this nation, if the Lord be God, then follow him. But if Baal, then follow him and go to hell. Tonight, America stands at the crossroads. And as Elijah came to the summit of Mount Carmel to make a declaration, we've come this night to Capitol Hill to declare that our God is not Baal, our God is not Moloch, our God is not government, our God is not money, our God is not power, not pleasure, our God is not political correctness or any other man-made thing. We've come to this hill to declare that there is only one God, and he is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He's the God of Israel and of all nations. He alone is the rock upon which this nation has come into existence. And from this high place, we make this declaration. We will not bow down our knees to Baal. We will not bow down our knees to political correctness. We will not bow down our knees to a morality that is as shifting as sand in the wind. We will not bow down our knees to the laws and precepts of rebellion or the sacred cows of moral apostasy. We will not bow down our knees to the idols of man. We will not bow down to Baal. We will bow down our knees only to the Lord our God, come what may, and we will have no other gods before him. For some trust in chariots, some trust in princes, some trust in Supreme Courts, some trust in White Houses, some trust in governments, some trust in Wall Street, some trust in powers, and some trust in idols. But we will trust in the name of the Lord our God, the name above all names, above all kings, above all powers. We will trust in the only name given by which we can be saved. We will trust in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Messiah, the King of all kings, the Lord of all lords, the Judge of all judges, the light of the world, the glory of Israel, the foundation stone upon which this nation came into existence, and the only answer, the only chance, and the only hope that America has, that it might once again shine with the light of the fire of the presence of the glory of the living God and not go to hell. So help us God. Thank you.
Brother David brought that to my attention about 3 weeks ago, and I've not been able to play it because I couldn't get the audio on it, but I wanted you to see that. And tonight, this is Jonathan Kahn, he's a rabbi, Jewish rabbi, so I appreciate what the man had to say. And he was speaking to Congress and Senate, or to the senators, or Congress it was. I'm sorry. I'll get it one of these times. So, may the Lord bless you tonight. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you for your children. They've been patient. They've been patient with me through this day. Lord, for the words that we heard here tonight from this message of this man that, Lord, has been willing to make a stand. So I pray, Lord, that you would help us in this hour to make our stand for you and to live faithfully to you in all things. Bless us, we pray now, in Jesus Christ's name. Some of them asked him, said, aren't you afraid to say these things? He said, I'm afraid not to. So praise the Lord tonight. Turn the service over to Brother Bud this time.
Yeah, Yea, surely my people, yea, will I not send a warning, saith the Lord? Yea, I have sent my servant, yea, to stay with these words. Surely the time is short. Yea, I would say unto thee, wouldest thou not examine thy life? Yea, and look unto those things which thou thinkest important. Let me say unto thee now, yea, they are not important at all. Yea, I say unto thee, prepare thy life and thine heart. Surely my coming is near.
Yes.
My people, I say unto thee, there shall come things upon this earth that no man has seen.
Yes, Lord.
But it is in my hand, saith the Lord.
Yes.
Great fear shall fall upon them. Yea, they shall cry out for the God to help them. But I say the very God that they cry for, they have turned against.
Yes. Yes.
Yea, time is short. Look unto me, I am able to take care of thy needs. Put thy trust in me, saith the Lord.
Yes. Thank you, Father. Yes, Lord. We put our trust in you. We wait upon you, Father. We praise you for your grace. And I thank you for my brothers and sisters tonight. Bless your holy name. Yes, Father. Amen.
Again, it lets us know we're getting to the end time. Let us all stand. If you have a need and you'd like to come for prayer, then feel free. Brother David comes.
Thy name. without you holding my hand. The mountains too high and the valleys too wide. Hold down all my knees. Oh, I learn to stand, but Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Now one day I made Jesus my all in all. From now on, when I'm in trouble, on his name I'll call. And if I don't trust him, I'll be less than a man, because I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Oh Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. The mountains too high and the valleys too wide. Hold down all my knees. Oh, I learn to stand, but Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Oh Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. The mountains too high and the valleys too wide. Hold down all my knees. Oh, I learn to stand. Oh, Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Now one day I made Jesus my all in all. From now on, when I'm in trouble, on his name I'll call. And if I don't trust him, I'll be less than a man, because I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Oh Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. The mountains too high and the valleys too wide. Hold down on my knees. That's where I learned to stand. But Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Without you holding my hand, the mountains too high and the valleys too wide. Hold down on my knees, that's where I learn to stand. My Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Lord, here I am again, down on my knees in prayer. And Lord, you promised me that you would always meet me there. Now there's a mountain up ahead that I can't seem to climb. So I'm begging for the strength, dear Lord, to try it one more time. Oh, Lord, don't move that mountain. Just give me strength to climb. For if you should move that mountain, I might grow weaker every time. And just as your son Jesus took that cross of Calvary's hill, oh Lord, don't move that mountain, so I may better do your will. Now if there were no mountains, Lord, I might forget to pray. And if there were no trials, Lord, I might even stray. But I know the higher the mountain, oh, the sweeter the victory. Oh, Lord, ever remind me that you will walk beside of me. Oh, Lord, don't move that mountain. Just give me strength to climb. For if you should move that mountain, I might grow weaker every time. And just as your son Jesus took that cross up Calvary's hill, oh Lord, don't move that mountain, so I may better do your will. Oh Lord, don't move that mountain, just give me strength to climb. For if you should move each mountain, I might grow weaker every time. And just as your son Jesus, he took that cross up Calvary's hill, oh Lord, don't move that mountain, so I may better do your will. Oh Lord, don't move that mountain, just give me strength to climb. For if you should move each mountain, I might grow weaker every time. Oh, and just as your son Jesus He took that cross of Calvary's hill. Oh Lord, don't move that mountain so I may better do your will. And just as your son Jesus, he took that cross up Calvary's hill. Oh Lord, don't move that mountain so I may better do your will.
Hallelujah. Glory to God. God is good all the time. Praise the Lord. Remember all of your brothers and sisters that are standing in need of prayer. And remember the service Thursday night and come back praying. Brother Mark Allen, would you dismiss us in prayer?
This day, thank you for the word you heard, the truth. Thank you for all your blessings, your loving kindness and mercy. Help us through the week that we might keep you in our minds and hearts. Lead us and guide us through the week. And help each and every one with their health problems, Lord, in their spiritual life. Lead us, guide us, protect us on the way home. In Jesus Christ's name we pray, amen.